Hello everyone, in this video we are going to see the revision notes of unit number 2. Let us first discuss the one dimension steady state heat conduction with the internal heat generation. So there are many examples in the nature which have a phenomena of internal heat generation. For example, a wire carrying a current. So when the current flows through the wire, what happens? The heat generation takes place. The heat try to generation takes place at the center of the wire. So from it, heat generation is a volumetric phenomena, that is, it occurs throughout the body of the medium. It is, its unit is watt per meter cube. For isotropic material, the differential equation of heat conduction, it is given by del square T by del x square plus del square T by del y square plus del square T by del z square plus Q bar by K equal to rho Cp divided by K into del T by del T, where the first three terms are nothing, are replaced by a Laplace operator square divided T plus Q bar by K. Q bar by K is nothing but a heat generation term. Rho Cp divided by K, it is a reciprocal of thermal diffusivity, and dou T by dou T is nothing but your change in the temperature with respect to time. So the first term is going to take care of change in the temperature in all direction x, y, z. The second term, that is Q bar by K, is going to take care of heat generation. Then the third term, it is going to take care of the thermal diffusivity, reciprocal of thermal diffusivity, and the fourth term is going to take care of the variation of a temperature with respect to time. So there are total four different forms of this differential equation. The first form is Fourier equation, where no heat generation phenomena takes place. Therefore, the Q bar by K from the above equation will become zero in a Fourier equation. In a Poisson equation, the steady state condition occurs. So change in the temperature with respect to time is going to become zero. So right hand side is going to become zero of this differential equation. Then the third equation is Laplace equation, where no heat generation takes place as well as steady state condition occur. So where delta T by delta T is equal to zero and Q bar by K is equal to zero. So you have Laplace operator square is equal to zero. And the fourth one is unidirectional Poisson equation, where the y and z direction are not considered. Therefore, in a above equation of a differential equation, del square T by del x square plus Q bar by K is equal to zero will be the unidirectional Poisson equation. And this equation is very much important to derive the temperature distribution in a slab with a heat generation. So unidirectional Poisson equation has been used for deriving a temperature distribution in a slab with a internal heat generation. So the temperature distribution in a slab is given by Q bar by 2k b square minus x square plus Q bar by h into b plus tf, where b is the thickness of a slab and x is the point where the temperature is to be measured. The temperature distribution in a slab is parabolic, as from the above equation T is proportional to the b square. So the nature of the curve of temperature distribution is parabolic. The maximum temperature occurs at the center of a slab. Therefore, when we need to find out the maximum temperature in our equation, we need to place x equal to 0. Therefore, T max equal to Q bar by 2k b square plus Q bar by h b plus Tf. While the surface temperature is been found out by replacing x equal to b in the above equation. So the surface temperature is equal to Q bar by H B plus Tf, and the heat transfer through this surface is been given by, it is equal to area into thickness into Q bar. Q bar is the amount of heat generated per volume. So we need to multiply internal heat generation per volume by its volume, that is A into B. Therefore, we are going to get heat transfer rate of the slab. Then the temperature distribution in the case of a solid cylinder, the same phenomena, only the cylindrical coordinates are being used in the form of a unidirectional Poisson equation to obtain this relation t equal to q bar by 4k into capital R square minus small r square plus q bar by 2h capital R plus df, where capital R is the radius of the solid cylinder and R is the intermediate radius at which you need to find out the temperature, where k is the thermal conductivity and h is the heat transfer coefficient. Tf is the fluid temperature. Here the maximum temperature occurs at a center, so to find out maximum temperature you need to replace small r equal to capital R. At a surface you need to place small r equal to capital R, and at the center you need to place small r equal to 0. So here I have done a mistake, so here it should be small r equal to 0. The temperature distribution in a solid sphere with a heat generation. In a case of a solid sphere, again you have to use a spherical coordinate to find out a temperature distribution. So it has been given by q bar by 6k r square minus r square plus q bar by 3h r plus tf. So at a center you need to place r equal to 0, small r equal to 0, and at a surface you need to place small r equal to capital R. So maximum temperature occur at a surface, center, and minimum temperature occur at a surface. Now this was related with chapter number 1. Chapter number 2 is consist of a heat transfer through extended surface. Now in extended surface we are going to increase the heat transfer rate of a convection either by increasing the convection heat transfer coefficient or by increasing the surface area. So we have only two options for increasing the heat transfer by convection. The third option, that is a temperature difference, it is going to remain constant for a particular application. So in order to increase the convection heat transfer coefficient, we must install a pump and a fan, but which is not feasible from the economic and the design point of view. So the second option come in the mind is the increasing surface area. So how to increase the surface area? It has been increased by increasing the effective area, which keeps the cost and space requirement unchanged by using the extended surface called as a fins. So fins are being used to increase the effective area over a surface and to promote the heat transfer rate by a mode of heat transfer known as a convection. Some of the application of the fins are being listed over here. On cylinder head of a IC engine, on cylinder of a reciprocating compressor, car radiator, heat sink used in the electronic circuit, outer casing of an electrical motor. So different types of fins we have depend upon their shape: rectangular fin, trapezoidal fins, spines, helical fins, annular fins and longitudinal fins. So heat transfer through the fins are taken place by the two mode of heat transfer: conduction, that is throughout the fin material, and convection between the fin surface and the surrounding fluid. There are two most important terms in a fin chapter, that is effectiveness and the efficiency. Let us understand the effectiveness. It gives the percentile change in the heat flow rate caused by the fin, while efficiency gives the percentile increase in the effective area of a system. In other words, effectiveness, it is the ratio of a rate of heat from a fin surface to the rate of a heat flow from a covered part of a base surface when exposed to the surrounding fluid. In simple word, the effectiveness, it is the ratio of a heat transfer obtained with fin to the heat transfer obtained without fin. So you can keep this thing in mind. The effectiveness, it is a ratio of a heat transfer obtained with fin and the heat to the heat transfer obtained without fin. And the efficiency, it has been defined as the actual heat, it is the ratio of actual heat rate obtained from the fin to the maximum possible rate of a heat flow from the same fin. So it is actual upon theoretical, in other words. So it has been given by Q actual divided by Q maximum. The concept of a pin fin. So in a experiment of a pin fin, we have conducted an experiment of a pin fin to determine the effectiveness of a PINFIN. But what do you mean by PINFIN? When the fin follows certain assumptions where its length of a fin is so much greater than the cross-sectional area in a such a way that heat conduction is unidirectional and it's along the length, then we called it as a PINFIN. The second is thermal conductivity of a fin must be high. So if it satisfies these two assumptions, then it is called as a PINFIN. Next is classification of PINFIN. The fin with an insulated end, long fin, and fin with the convection of its end. The fin with an insulated end means what? At the end, the temperature gradient is equal to zero. The temperature gradient at the end of fin is equal to zero. The long fin, the temperature at the end of fin almost equal to the surrounding fluid temperature. A long fin. And third is fin with the convection of its end. Neither the temperature gradient is zero nor the temperature of each of a fin equal to surrounding fluid temperature. The differential equation of a PINFIN, d square theta by dx square minus hp divided by ka theta is equal to 0. So this is the differential equation of a fin, where hp ka is equal to m square and h is the heat transfer coefficient, p is the perimeter of a fin, k is the thermal conductivity of a fin, and a is the cross-sectional area. So we are going to replace hp divided by ka equal to m square, and therefore m equal to under root of hp divided by ka, where theta is the temperature difference between the temperature of a surface of a fin and the surrounding fluid. So as per this is the second order differential equation, the solution of a second order differential equation, it has been given by theta equal to c1 e raised to mx plus c2 e raised to minus mx. So where h is the heat transfer coefficient, p is the perimeter of fin, a is the cross-sectional area, k is the thermal conductivity of fin, and x is the distance at which temperature is to be found. So comparison table has been made here, where the parameters are been chosen. The temperature distribution in a case of insulated fin, it has been given by theta by theta naught equal to hyperbolic cos of m into l minus x divided by hyperbolic cos of ml. While in a case of infinite long fin, theta by theta naught equal to e raised to mx, where theta naught is the temperature difference between the base temperature of a fin and the surrounding temperature. The heat transfer rate, it has been given by under root of hp ka theta naught hyperbolic of tan ml in a case of a insulated fin, and in case of infinite you have q equal to under root of hp ka theta naught. Fin efficiency, it is in a case of insulated hyperbolic tan ml of divided by ml. In a case of infinite long, it is just 1 upon ml. Effectiveness, it has been given by tan of ml, the hyperbolic tan of ml divided by under root of hp ka, while in case of a infinite long fin, it is under root of pk divided by ha. And the last one, the relationship between the fin effectiveness and efficiency, it is the ratio of effectiveness to the efficiency, it is the ratio of surface area of the fin to the cross sectional area of a fin. Therefore pl divided by a, p is the perimeter, l is the length of the fin, and a is the cross sectional area of the fin. So this going through this notes of unit number 2 will clear all your concept and help you for the upcoming examination. Thank you all for watching this video.